Welcome to my video tutorial on identification of systemic histology slides, part 3. In this video, we will learn the identification features of slides belong to following systems: urinary system, male and female reproductive systems. Under urinary system, we will see the slides of kidney, ureter and urinary bladder. Under male reproductive system, testis, epididymis, vas deferens and prostate gland. Under female reproductive system, we will see the slides of uterus, ovary, fallopian tube, mammary gland, placenta and umbilical cord. In total, we will be looking into 13 systemic histology slides. A note before we begin, slides shown in this video are hematoxylin and eosin stained slides and the images are taken through a camera phone. Kindly ignore any artifacts in the slides. Let's begin with the slides belong to urinary system. Kidney. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of renal corpuscles, proximal and distal convoluted tubules along with loops of Henle. Renal parenchyma is divided into outer renal cortex and inner renal medulla. Let's see the features of renal cortex under high magnification. It shows vessels, capillary plexuses and parts of nephrons. Renal corpuscles. They are formed by Bowman's capsule enclosing a renal space and glomerulus formed by capillary plexus with mesangial cells. Bowman's capsule. It's a cup-shaped structure of nephron having outer parietal layer lined by squamous cells and inner visceral layer lined by podocytes which can be observed under electron microscopy. Bowman's capsule is continuous with proximal convoluted tubule, which is lined by eosinophilic columnar cells with brush border. Their cytoplasm take more amount of eosin. Proximal convoluted tubules or PCTs are continuous with thick descending segments or proximal limb of loop of Henle. They are lined by cuboidal cells with brush border. Renal cortex also shows distal convoluted tubules or DCTs. They are lined by pale staining cuboidal cells having narrow lumen. There are specialized cells grouped at the vascular pole of each renal corpuscle known as juxtaglomerular apparatus, which is formed by macula densa, juxtaglomerular cells or JG cells, and lasis cells. Macula densa is formed by overlapping crowded columnar cells. They are modified cuboidal cells lining the distal convoluted tubule. JG cells are modified smooth muscle cells of afferent arteriole. They secrete renin. Lasis cells, they are modified mesangial cells. They show lace-like network forming processes and they contain receptors for angiotensin II. Let's see the features of renal medulla under low magnification. Here is the renal medulla, which shows loops of Henle and collecting ducts. Let's observe them under high magnification. Here are the thin segments of loops of Henle, which are lined by squamous cells. They have narrow lumen. They continuous with thick ascending limb or distal limbs of loops of Henle. They are lined by cuboidal cells. Renal medulla also shows larger collecting ducts, which are lined by cuboidal cells. Basically, renal cortex shows renal corpuscles, PCTs, DCTs with thick descending segments of loops of Henle along with JG apparatus, whereas renal medulla shows thin segments of loops of Henle along with thick ascending segments and collecting ducts. Ureter. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of mucosal folds lined by transitional epithelium with a star-shaped lumen and a thick muscular coat in its wall. Wall of the ureter is composed of three layers. From inside to outside they are mucosa, muscular coat and adventitia. Mucosa is thrown into longitudinal folds and it is lined by transitional epithelium. Let's observe that under high magnification. Here is the transitional epithelium having basal columnar cells and luminal larger umbrella cells. Such epithelium is supported by underlying lamina propria, which is formed by loose connective tissue with blood vessels. Coming to the muscular coat, it is formed by inner longitudinal and outer circular smooth muscle layers. But in the distal part of ureter, muscular coat is formed by three layers, inner and outer longitudinal and middle circular smooth muscle layers. Coming to the outermost layer, adventitia, which is formed by loose connective tissue with blood vessels. Urinary bladder. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of mucosal folds lined by transitional epithelium and a thick muscular coat formed by inner and outer longitudinal, middle circular smooth muscle layers. Wall of the urinary bladder shows three layers. From inside to outside they are mucosa, muscular coat and serosa or adventitia. Mucosa is thrown into longitudinal folds similar to ureter. It is lined by transitional epithelium, which is supported by underlying thick lamina propria, which is formed by smooth muscles, loose connective tissue and blood vessels. Coming to muscular coat, which is a thick layer formed by detrusor muscle. It shows three indistinct smooth muscle layers. They are inner longitudinal, middle circular and outer longitudinal smooth muscle layers. Such muscular coat is lined by outer serosa or adventitia, which is formed by loose connective tissue lined by squamous epithelium. Here are the three slides belong to urinary system. Let's quickly revise their identification features. Kidney, it shows outer renal cortex and inner renal medulla. Renal cortex can be identified by the presence of renal corpuscles. Proximal convoluted tubules lined by eosinophilic columnar cells with brush border and distal convoluted tubules lined by pale staining cuboidal cells. Renal medulla can be identified by the presence of thin segments of loops of Henle lined by squamous epithelium and collecting ducts lined by cuboidal epithelium. Ureter, it is identified by the presence of mucosal folds lined by transitional epithelium having a star-shaped lumen and a thick muscular coat formed by inner longitudinal, outer circular smooth muscle layers. Coming to urinary bladder, it shows mucosal folds lined by transitional epithelium supported by a thick lamina propria and a thick muscular coat having three indistinct layers of smooth muscles, inner and outer longitudinal and middle circular smooth muscle layers. Let's see the slides of male reproductive system. Testis. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of seminiferous tubules having Sertoli cells and different cells of spermatogenesis. Testis is covered by a thick fibrous layer known as tunica albuginea, which is one of its three coverings. It sends septa into the parenchyma and divides it into lobules. Each lobule of testis contains seminiferous tubules, which are separated by loose connective tissue, having blood vessels and interstitial cells of Leydig. Let's observe them under high magnification. Here is one seminiferous tubule surrounded by loose connective tissue, which show blood vessels and interstitial cells of Leydig. They are large polyhedral cells with spherical nucleus. Their cytoplasm take more amount of eosin and they possess receptors for luteinizing hormone. Under the influence of luteinizing hormone, they secrete testosterone. Now let's focus on seminiferous tubule, which contain Sertoli cells and cells of different stages of spermatogenesis. Here are the Sertoli cells. They are tall columnar or tall pyramidal cells with vertically oval nucleus. and the cytoplasm take more amount of eosin. Sertoli cells are basically supporting cells. They provide nutrition to developing cells of spermatogenesis, which are seen to be anchored by Sertoli cells, which is why Sertoli cells are also called as sustentacular cells. They also participate in phagocytosis and hormone secretion. Adjacent Sertoli cells make cell junctions with their cytoplasmic processes so that the gap between two Sertoli cells is divided into two compartments, basal compartment towards the basement membrane and luminal compartment towards the lumen of the tubule. Basal compartment is occupied by spermatogonia, which are developmentally two types, type A and type B. Type B spermatogonia undergo mitosis and give rise to primary spermatocytes. They are large spherical cells, more in number. They occupy the luminal compartment adjacent to the Sertoli cells. Primary spermatocytes undergo meiosis I division and they give rise to secondary spermatocytes, which are small spherical cells, occupy luminal compartment. Secondary spermatocytes undergo meiosis II division and they give rise to spermatids, which are smaller spherical cells compared to spermatocytes. They are seen to be embedded in the apical part of the Sertoli cells. Such spermatids undergo metamorphosis. They shed their cytoplasm, which is engulfed by Sertoli cells, and they transform into mature spermatozoa. Such process of transformation from spermatids to spermatozoa is known as spermiogenesis. Spermatozoa, they are seen at the apical surfaces of Sertoli cells with their eosin-stained immotile tail projecting into the lumen of seminiferous tubule. So basically, testis is identified by the presence of seminiferous tubules with Sertoli cells and different cells of spermatogenesis. Epididymis. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of coils of duct of epididymis filled with sperms. Epididymis is surrounded by loose connective tissue having blood vessels. It shows a single duct which coils upon itself so that on a cross section we will find multiple sections of single duct of epididymis. Such duct is lined by pseudostratified columnar epithelium with stereocilia. Let's observe that under high magnification. Here is the junction of three sections of coiled single duct of epididymis, which is lined by pseudostratified columnar epithelium with stereocilia. Stereocilia are large microvilli which help in absorption of fluids from testicular secretion which has reached the epididymis from testis. Coils of duct of epididymis are surrounded by smooth muscle cells and blood vessels. Contraction of such smooth muscle cells help in transport of spermatozoa from epididymis towards vas deferens. Vas deferens or ductus deferens. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of mucosal folds lined by pseudostratified columnar epithelium with stereocilia and a thick muscular coat in its wall. Wall of the vas deferens is composed of three layers. From inside to outside they are mucosa, muscular coat and adventitia. Let's observe the features of mucosa under high magnification. Mucosa is thrown into longitudinal folds. It is lined by pseudostratified columnar epithelium with stereocilia. Such epithelium is supported by underlying thin lamina propria, which is composed of elastic fibers along with blood vessels. Let's see the muscular coat under low magnification. It is the thick layer of the wall composed of three prominent layers in the distal part of vas deferens. They are inner and outer longitudinal and middle circular smooth muscle layers. Outermost layer is adventitia, which is composed of loose connective tissue along with blood vessels and nerve fibers. Prostate gland. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of a thick capsule, fibromuscular tissue and glandular tissue showing alveoli with mucosal infoldings. Prostatic parenchyma contains fibromuscular stroma and prostatic glands. Fibromuscular stroma is composed of smooth muscles, collagen and elastic fibers along with blood vessels and nerve fibers. Such fibromuscular stroma supports the prostatic glands. Let's observe the prostatic glands under high magnification. There are three types of prostatic glands: mucosal, submucosal and main prostatic glands. Mucosal glands, they are simple tubular glands lined by simple cuboidal epithelium. They are ductless glands, so they directly open into prostatic urethra. Submucosal glands, they are tubulo-alveolar glands with small alveoli and ducts. They are lined by simple columnar epithelium. Coming to main prostatic glands, they are compound tubulo-alveolar glands with large alveoli and ducts. Their alveoli show mucosal infoldings and they are lined by pseudostratified columnar epithelium. Their ducts are lined by simple columnar epithelium. With advanced age, prostatic alveoli show eosinophilic prostatic concretions in their lumen, which is known as corpora amylacea. It is nothing but calcified glycoprotein of prostatic secretions, which fills the lumen of prostatic alveoli with advanced age. Here are the four slides belong to male reproductive system. Let's quickly revise their identification features. Testis, it is identified by the presence of seminiferous tubules with Sertoli cells and different cells of spermatogenesis. Epididymis is identified by the presence of sections of coils of single duct of epididymis filled with sperms. Vas deferens is identified by mucosal infoldings lined by pseudostratified columnar epithelium with stereocilia and a thick muscular coat in its wall. Prostate gland is identified by the presence of a thick capsule, fibromuscular stroma and prostatic glands with their larger alveoli and mucosal infoldings. Now let's see the slides of female reproductive system. Uterus. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of endometrium with uterine glands and myometrium with numerous blood vessels. Wall of the uterus shows three layers. From inside to outside they are endometrium, myometrium and perimetrium. Endometrium, it is lined by simple columnar epithelium which is supported by underlying thick stroma which contain simple tubular uterine glands along with spiral arteries and stromal cells. Uterine glands are formed by indentations of endometrial epithelium into underlying stroma. So they are lined by simple columnar epithelium. Stroma of endometrium is functionally divided into three strata. From inside to outside they are stratum compactum, which show tightly packed uterine glands. Deep to that is the stratum spongiosum, which give a spongy appearance to endometrium because of the uterine glands. Deep to that is the stratum basale, which contain bottoms of uterine glands close to myometrium. Endometrium shows structural changes during different phases of uterine cycle. In menstrual phase, most of the endometrium is shed off along with the epithelium, leaving only the bottoms of uterine glands in stratum basale. In proliferative phase, stromal cells proliferate to restore the thickness of the endometrium. Glands increase in their length and the glandular epithelium proliferate to form the endometrial epithelium. In secretory phase, uterine glands further enlarge and they give a zigzag appearance. Basically, depending on the size and shape of the uterine glands along with the thickness of endometrium. Phase of the uterine cycle can be identified. So here the slide belongs to uterus at its beginning of secretory phase with enlarged uterine glands. Now let's see the myometrium. It shows three ill-defined layers. They are inner and outer longitudinal and middle irregular smooth muscle layers. Here the middle layer shows numerous blood vessels. Outermost layer is perimetrium, which is formed by connective tissue lined by simple squamous epithelium. Ovary. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of different stages of developing ovarian follicles in outer cortex and connective tissue with blood vessels in inner medulla. Surface of the ovary is lined by germinal epithelium, which is nothing but simple cuboidal epithelium. It is supported by underlying a thin layer of condensed connective tissue known as tunica albuginea. Let's see the features of outer cortex, which contain stroma and follicles in different stages of development. Let's observe these under high magnification. Stroma contain fusiform mesenchymal cells, smooth muscle cells and reticular fibers. Coming to the follicles, developmentally there are four types of follicles observed in ovarian cortex. They are primordial, primary, secondary and mature Graafian follicles. Let's begin with the primordial follicle. Here it is. It is identified by a layer of flat stromal cells surrounding the primary oocyte. Primary follicle, here it is. It is identified by a layer of cuboidal or columnar cells surrounding the primary oocyte and separated from it by zona pellucida. Here the stromal cells are termed as follicular cells. Coming to the secondary follicle, where the follicular cells proliferate to form multiple layers of granulosa cells known as membrana granulosa. And it acquire follicular cavity which is filled with Leiker folliculi. Further, secondary follicle grows in size and become a larger mature Graafian follicle which is filled with Leiker folliculi surrounded by membrana granulosa. And it shows eccentrically placed oocyte which is not shown here. And the follicular cells which surround the oocyte are known as cumulus oophoricus. And the cells which attach the oocyte to the wall of the Graafian follicle known as discus proligerus. Such Graafian follicle is surrounded by two coverings. Let's observe that under high magnification. Here is the Leiker folliculi and here is the membrana granulosa, which is surrounded by inner cellular theca interna formed by condensation of stromal cells and outer fibrous theca externa formed by condensation of connective tissue. The two thecal layers together termed as theca folliculi. During ovulation, Graafian follicle ruptures and its wall collapses. And the follicular cells enlarge in size, become polyhedral in shape and they acquire lipid vacuoles and lutein pigment in their cytoplasm. Such cells are known as luteal cells. Such post-ovulatory cellular mass which is still surrounded by theca folliculi is known as corpus luteum. Here the luteal cells secrete progesterone, whereas theca interna cells secrete estrogen. Under the failure of fertilization, cells of corpus luteum and theca interna cells undergo degeneration and they form a fibrous mass which is seen with a folded wall homogeneously stained with eosin. It is known as corpus albicans. Let's observe that under low magnification. Here is the corpus albicans, which is nothing but degenerated corpus luteum. In the same ovarian cycle, the other ovarian follicles which are simultaneously developing undergo degeneration as they do not enter into next ovarian cycle. Such degenerated ovarian follicles form small pale stained fibrous scars known as corpus atreticum. corpus albicans and corpus atreticum. They are seen as homogeneously stained eosin fibrous masses. So these are the characteristic features of outer ovarian cortex. Coming to the inner medulla, which contain connective tissue with blood vessels and smooth muscle fibers. Coming to the fallopian tube, here is the slide seen under low magnification. It can be identified as a muscular tube with mucosal folds filling the narrow lumen, and they are lined by ciliated columnar epithelium. Wall of the fallopian tube shows three layers. From inside to outside they are mucosa, muscular coat and serosa. Let's see the features of mucosa. It shows branching and anastomosing mucosal folds, which are lined by ciliated columnar epithelium. Let's observe that under high magnification. Here the epithelium shows two types of cells. Ciliated columnar cells, which help in movement of the ovum towards the uterus, and non-ciliated columnar cells, which are also known as PEC cells. Functionally, they are secretory cells and they help in nourishment of ovum which has reached the fallopian tube after ovulation. Let's see the muscular coat. It is formed by inner circular and outer longitudinal smooth muscle layers. Outermost layer is serosa, which is lined by squamous epithelium of peritoneum. Here are the three slides belong to female reproductive system so far covered. Let's quickly revise their identification features. Uterus, it is identified by the presence of endometrium with uterine glands and myometrium with numerous blood vessels. Ovary, it is identified by the presence of different stages of developing ovarian follicles in outer cortex and connective tissue with blood vessels in inner medulla. Fallopian tube is identified as a muscular tube with branching and anastomosing mucosal folds filling the lumen, and they are lined by ciliated columnar epithelium. Mammary gland. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of lobules, which are filled with fibrofatty tissue and glandular tissue having alveoli and larger lactiferous ducts. Mammary gland is a modified sweat gland. It is covered by skin. It is composed of stroma and parenchyma. Stroma contain fibrofatty tissue, which is composed of connective tissue and fat. Here the connective tissue forms fibrous septae, which divide the gland into 15 to 20 lobes, which are further divided into numerous small lobules. Fibrous septae carry blood vessels along with them towards the parenchyma. Let's see the parenchyma. It is composed of glandular tissue containing tubulo-alveolar glands. Let's observe them under high magnification. Here are the alveoli of glandular tissue, which are lined by columnar epithelium. They drain into intralobular ducts, which are lined by cuboidal epithelium. They further drain into interlobular ducts, which are lined by low columnar cells. They further drain into larger lactiferous ducts, which are lined by columnar epithelium. Basically, mammary gland is composed of fibrofatty stroma and glandular parenchyma. Stroma and parenchyma show structural changes during different growing phases of mammary gland. In inactive phase of the gland, stroma will be more with indistinct parenchyma. Whereas in active phase of the gland during pregnancy, there will be less stroma with well-developed parenchyma is observed. And in lactating phase, there will be less stroma and well-developed glandular tissue is observed having various sizes of alveoli filled with secretions. So here the slide belongs to mammary gland in lactating phase having less stroma with well-developed glandular tissue having larger alveoli filled with secretions. Placenta. Here is the slide seen under low magnification. It is identified by the presence of chorionic villi surrounded by intervillous spaces which are filled with maternal blood. And towards the fetal surface, it shows chorionic plate covered by amnion. Developmentally, chorionic villi are three types. They are primary, secondary, and tertiary villi. Let's observe them under high magnification. Primary villi, they show outer eosinophilic syncytiotrophoblasts and inner pale staining cytotrophoblasts. Secondary villi, they show outer eosinophilic syncytiotrophoblasts with pale staining cytotrophoblasts and inner mesodermal cells. Whereas tertiary villi are composed of outer syncytio and cytotrophoblasts with inner mesodermal cells along with fetal capillaries. Such tertiary villi show branching villi. In cross section, they are observed as floating villi. Coming to the intervillar space, it contains maternal blood cells, which are separated from fetal capillaries by placental barrier. Initially, placental barrier is formed by four layers: syncytiotrophoblasts, cytotrophoblasts, mesodermal cells, and endothelium of fetal capillary. During full term, the placental barrier becomes active and formed by only two layers: syncytiotrophoblasts and fetal capillary endothelium, and it participates in the exchange of nutrition. Coming to the chorionic plate, it is formed by from inside to outside syncytiotrophoblasts, cytotrophoblasts, extraembryonic mesoderm with fetal blood vessels. Chorionic plate is covered by amniotic layer, which consists of embryonic connective tissue lined by simple cuboidal epithelium. Umbilical cord. Here is the slide which can be observed completely without magnification. It is identified by the presence of three medium-sized vessels, two arteries and one vein, surrounded by Wharton's jelly, an amniotic layer. Let's observe these structures under low magnification. Here is the Wharton's jelly, which is nothing but mucoid embryonic connective tissue having star-shaped cells embedded in gelatinous matrix. Arteries, they are right and left umbilical arteries. Structurally, they are medium-sized or muscular arteries. They are identified with their thick wall having smooth muscles in their tunica media and narrow lumen. Coming to the vein, it is the left umbilical vein which is observed in umbilical cord. Structurally, it is medium-sized vein. It is identified with its thin wall having smooth muscle cells in its tunica media and large collapsed lumen. Here are the three more slides belong to female reproductive system. Let's quickly revise their identification features. Mammary gland is identified by the presence of lobules filled with fibrofatty stroma and glandular parenchyma. Placenta is identified by the presence of chorionic villi, maternal blood within the intervillar space. Towards the fetal surface, chorionic plate covered by amniotic layer. Umbilical cord is identified by the presence of three medium-sized vessels, two arteries and one vein, surrounded by Wharton's jelly and amniotic layer. Here is the end of this video, which includes systemic histology slides belong to urinary system, male and female reproductive systems. Thank you for your patient listening. Keep learning.